What's going on, guys? Balkan Architect here, and in today's video we're going to be talking about smart parametric rebar inside of Revit. So just like you can set up certain parameters and make your floor plan smart in Revit, well, you can do the same thing for rebar. So a few weeks ago I've released a video where I show you how to make your floor plan smarter, and I'm going to be including a link to that video up in the cards above. And then in today's video I'm just going to be showing you how to make your rebar smart inside of your concrete elements inside of Revit. Now before we jump into the tutorial itself, I would like to ask you to check out my website balkanarchitect.com. I'm going to link it up just below this video in the description and then also up in the cards above there. For example, for rebar I have a specific course where I teach you pretty much everything you should know about rebar in Revit, how to set everything up and how to do it in a very professional way so everything kind of works correctly and everything is, well, made parametric and smart. Now in addition to that course, I also have a template for exactly this, reinforced concrete and rebar inside of Revit. It's actually been created or developed by a structural engineer who has developed this template by working on some professional projects. So I think that's really interesting as well, and you can check that out on my website too. Okay, now without any further ado, let's jump straight into Revit. And here I have this foundation. It actually has rebar inside of it, and this was actually part of a different tutorial, so if you want to check that tutorial out, I'm going to be leaving a link up in the cards above. Okay, so now let's see how can we adjust this rebar. So we have a bunch of this rebar, as you can see, already in the column and in the foundation. That was done in that previous video. So let's open up the floor plan view and let's see what's going on here. So I'm first going to turn on the thin lines, and then also I'm just going to come in here and set the detail level to fine so we can see kind of actual thick rebar bars. And now it's time to start modifying them and adding some parameters. So unlike with architecture elements where you would, for parameters, you would just add dimensions and then you would label those dimensions or turn them into parameters, well, here it's a little bit different. So let me show you. When you select any rebar that has been placed inside of the model, if you go here to rebar constraints, this is where you set up those parameters. So instead of adding those dimensions kind of externally, you can do it internally. So you just click here on edit constraints and your rebar is going to turn green like this. And then you're going to see a few of these points. See this kind of blue line with a blue dot in the middle. And we can see we have multiple dots. Now, when you select one of those lines with or dots with a line going through it, it's going to turn orange. Now, not only the line is going to turn orange, but usually it's going to turn something else orange too. So in this case, you can see that this rebar cover has turned orange. If I deselect it or select something else, you can see the rebar cover is usually green and this was blue. Now, they are both orange. So what Revit is telling us here is that there is a parametric relationship or a constraint between this side of rebar, so this one which is highlighted in orange, and this rebar cover. So that's what Revit is telling us. However, if I come here and if I click on this external face of this column, you can see now this is going to highlight in orange. So what I select, that's going to be kind of the face or the reference to which we're going to be adjusting our rebar, or in this case just this side of rebar. So if I select this, what you'll see here is it's going to report zero. Well, that's because the rebar in this case is actually touching that rebar cover. Now here what you'll see is toggle rebar cover constraint, switch in between the face of the cover or the face of the element itself. So as you can see, if you click here, it's just going to toggle in between those two. And if you toggle and set it up to this face, as you can see here, it's going to report minus 29 millimeters, meaning that there is 29 millimeters here from here to here. So that's basically what that is telling us. Here you'll see we have these additional ones. So each side has one in the middle, and then here we have these, and I'm guessing that's because of the hooks. And again, when you select this, or no, sorry, this is the edge here. When you select this, as you can see, it's just going to give you, is it kind of attached to the face here, or is it attached to the rebar cover? And there we go. So that's basically how this works. Now I'm just going to cancel out of this, and then let me show you how that works for these vertical bars, because it's even more interesting there. So again, I'm just going to go here to edit edit constraints, and what you'll see here now is we have three of these bars, and we have just one straight line connecting them all, and then we have dots here in the middle, and then here we have these vertical lines. And in this case, only this one is highlighted. And here we have this arc that's also highlighted in orange. Now, as you can probably guess from the previous one, this is basically telling us that this bar here is attached or constrained to this middle point of this arc. Now, if I click here, it's going to attach to this tangent here. If I click here, it's going to attach to that tangent there, and basically that's what it's going to use. So in this case, as you can see, this is attached to the tangent here. This isn't, so it's still sticking here in the middle, and then I can just attach it there, and as you can see, it's going to go all the way to the other side, or alternatively, I can select the middle, and now as you can see, it's just telling me that the middle has to be here because the side is attached to a tangent. And now alternatively, I can select this thing. So it's just going to come straight to this horizontal bar. It's going to kind of be glued to it. And then here we have the value. Now in this case, the value is zero because they're touching, but here we have this whole toggle button, so we can switch for this dimension to be reporting kind of the exterior boundary of both bars and the distance in between those, which is in this case zero. Or if I click on the toggle, now it's going to, as you can see from the little sketch here, it's going to, or the little sketch, it's going to report from the center line to the center line of these two bars. So from here to here, it's 10 millimeters. So you can use both of those options. And then finally, here we have one more, and this is a toggle, and this is called a two-way constraint toggle. So in this case, as you can see, we have two bars, rebar bars, and we have one arrow in between those. However, if I click again, now we're going to have two arrows. So what does this mean? Well, if it's one arrow, that means that this bar, this vertical bar, or this, in this case, the set of vertical bars, is essentially connected to this horizontal bar here. However, this horizontal bar here is not connected to the vertical rebar. So it's only a one-way connection. So now if I hit finish, and if I decide to move this thing, if I select it and move it, it's just going to move out of the way. However, if I go back and then select that thing again, let's go to edit constraints, select it again, click here, and if I toggle this on so it's a two-way connection, now the horizontal line is connected to the vertical rebar. And now if I hit finish, and if I decide to move this thing, as you can see, the rebar bar is going to move along with it. Now obviously on this side, this thing moved, so perhaps let's try something. So if I go to this side, and let's go here to edit constraints, come to the middle here, let's say I want to attach it here, perfect. And then again, I make it a two-way connection here as well. Now, when I hit finish, and when I decide to move this thing, let's see what happens. As you can see, it's even going to move these rebar bars here as well. So just be careful when you're moving things once you've constrained it completely, because it is going to want to behave in a certain way. So now we've covered kind of how to constrain things within a single concrete element, and in this case that was a column. So what happens if we come to this section here, and let's look at those bars again. So these are the same bars that we were manipulating previously. And here we don't want them to be constrained just inside of this element, the column. We actually want it to go down into the foundation. So in that case, I can go here to edit constraints, and then I can come here and I can select this constraint here. And as you can see, it's for some reason it's using the bottom of the foundation as a constraint. I can just switch that, and I can use the tab key here and set it to the bottom of the column, and then I can say, okay, I want you to extend, and then I can write whatever number I want here. So I can say just 380, and now it's always going to stick at 380 from the bottom of this column. I can of course use the rebar cover if I want. So for example, I can click here and then give a different value. I can select any part of the foundation as well. So I can really play around and choose which element works best for this particular constraint. And there you go. That's how you can make your rebar smart. Now do keep in mind that once you create your rebar, it's usually going to start off with some constraints. So it's not like when you create rebar that it's not going to be constrained to anything. It usually is. Well, as far as I know, in all cases, it's going to be constrained usually to the rebar cover. However, if you want to perhaps customize it a little bit, you can. And then when you decide to make any changes, so for example, if I switch this column, make it bigger or something, the rebar is going to kind of adapt to that change that we have made, and that's exactly what we want to see in Revit. We want things to be smart, parametric, and constrained. Okay, I hope you have enjoyed this video. If you want to get this Revit project files, or this Revit project file, or any of my other Revit project files, you can find that on my Patreon page. I'm going to include a link to it just below this video in the description, and then also up in the cards above. Thank you for watching, guys. Make sure to check out my website, balkanarchitect.com, for more Revit courses. There I have over 120 hours of content, and I'm adding more each week. Make sure to subscribe for more videos, and also I've added a video over there that might interest you as well.